you're good and you're gracious, oh, holy, holy, Lord Almighty, good and gracious King, you deserve the greater glory. Overcome with joy, I sing to the King. Gracious King Yahweh, gracious God, you're a good and gracious King Yahweh, you're a good and gracious.
Welcome, everybody, to Bible Study at Calvary Chapel. It's good to see brothers and sisters here this evening. It was a rough day. Let's all stand together if you can. Father God, Yahweh, the Lord God Almighty, the one who is high and lifted up, the Ancient of Days, when your presence landed on Mount Sinai, it just exploded in fire and smoke, Lord. Who is this great God we serve? Lord, we cannot fathom. Our spirits could not even behold your face and live anymore in human flesh, Lord, for your great glory. Even the angels that fly around your throne have wings to cover themselves so they don't get annihilated by who you are. You're so awesome and mighty, Lord. Oh, Lord, that we would just get a deeper glimpse into your holiness and greatness, just a little bit. Oh, how humbly, Lord, we would walk every day in the fear and awe of the Lord. Father, we thank you that as mighty and holy and awesome as you are, you so love the world that you gave Jesus Christ. You came down, your Son came down, God the Son, and was born into a human body to be our atoning sacrifice, to bring the kingdom of heaven to earth, to be the door through which all humanity must enter and can be saved and adopted into your family. We thank you, Lord, for what you've made available to us because you love us and you want all to come in. We honor you tonight and we pray that we will have ears to hear what your word has to say, your eternal living word. May it find a resting place forever in our hearts for your glory. Amen.
Eternal God, unchanging, mysterious and unknown. Your boundless love, unfailing grace and mercy shown. Bright seraphim in ceaseless flight around your glorious throne. They raise their voices day and night in praise to you alone. Hallelujah! Glory be to our great God.
Lord, we are weak, frail, helpless in this storm. Surround us with your angels, hold us in your arms. Our cold and ruthless enemy, his pleasure is our harm. Oh, rise up, oh Lord, and he must flee before our sovereign God. Let every creature in the sea and every flying bird, let every mountain, every field and valley of the earth, let all the moons and all the stars in all the sing praises to our living God who rules them by his word. Hallelujah! Glory be to our great God. Hallelujah! Glory be to our great God. So great and so holy, yet Lord, you're so personal. Awesome God, personal God.
Grander earth is quaked before, moved by the sound of his voice. Seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken for my regard. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Our portion through Jesus Christ. Far be it from me to not believe, even when my eyes can't see, and the
this mountain that's in front of me. It must be thrown into the midst of the sea. Lord, we thank you that when we trust in you, we're not just taking a blind leap into an abyss of the unknown, Lord, because we have your word. We know what your character is like, Lord. You have proved yourself, Lord. For how can we not trust the one who would go to the cross of Calvary for us? He already demonstrated how much he loved us. He doesn't delight in harming us. He's a good, holy God. And we thank you, Lord, that we can trust you today. Amen. You may be seated.
Good evening. Let's just begin with prayer. I appreciated that last song. Father God, just as we're singing that last song, Lord, it's a reminder that even when our eyes can't see what's happening, Lord, when we can't see with our physical eyes, or really even our spiritual eyes, why something might or might not be happening, what's going on, why we are where we are, Lord. You give us perspective, and that perspective is, it doesn't really matter because you're in control. And Lord, thank you for the perspective that Job receives in this chapter this evening. Thank you for reminding us that no matter what our eyes see, Lord, when we look around in this fallen world, you are the rock and the foundation, and you've got this, and we're trusting you. Lord, it doesn't always make sense to us, but it doesn't have to. And I'm thankful that you're a good God, and we can trust even when it doesn't make sense. Because you love us, and sometimes that's just really all that we needed to know. And so would you speak to us this evening, Lord, through your word? As you spoke to Job, would you speak to our hearts what we need to hear, Lord, so that we can draw near to you this evening? We thank you, and we pray in your son Jesus' name. Amen. So, several years ago, I was really excited that one of my favorite bands, Jars of Clay, they were going to be playing at the Palace Theater, which is really just right down the road from us. And they were a pretty big name to be playing in such a small place. And I was really excited about it. I remember a really good concert. I remember singing along with some of my favorite songs and being really excited and encouraged by, you know, seeing all these other people around me singing these same songs from the community that I was from, that I'm currently still part of. And I just remember a lot of good things about that concert. The crowd was small enough that actually I kind of lingered a little afterwards there at the Palace, and I was able to wander around. And I briefly talked with all four members of the band, which was kind of cool. And I'm not really like an autograph hound or anything like that, so I didn't, you know, trouble them for autographs. I just kind of thanked them for being there and asked them, you know, I said, I hope they would come back, and I don't know that they have. And hopefully it wasn't because of me. You know, that Dave guy, whatever his deal was, I don't think it had anything to do with that. But for me, it was quite the memorable night. They may not remember it, but I remember it. Now, there was also a guy who played before them. And I remember he played djembe because, you know, I play cajon up here a lot. But my first hand percussion instrument was djembe. And I was like, oh, this guy's playing djembe, and he's playing in front of a crowd. This is pretty cool. And, you know, that's really all I know about the guy. I don't remember a whole lot about the style of music he played, besides the fact that he played the djembe some. I can't remember any of his songs. I don't remember his name. And such is the life sometimes of an opening act, you know. Most people don't actually come to see the opening act, you know? They come to see the artist who's the main act, right? So the opening act, they have the task, the difficult task sometimes, of trying to win some of the audience over and to try to get them in the mood for what's coming next, that main act that everybody really came to see or hear. And I say all this because I look back at the last time, the only time that I spoke about Elihu, and I'm realizing, you know, maybe I was a bit harsh on Elihu, a little bit bitter with all of his other friends, Job's friends, just kind of beating down this guy. And I was like, here comes Elihu. He's just going to dogpile. It's just another guy. And while there were some things that he said that certainly I take some question with, I guess, you know, given the frame of mind and state that Job was in, I look back and I think that some good things happened there. You know, actually, as I'm saying it now, I realized after the first time, I walked off and I was talking and I said, I don't even think his name is Elihu, is it? And it was, no, it's Elihu. I didn't even know the guy's name, right? And it kind of got me thinking and chuckling, you know. But ultimately, some of the things he said, they were dead on. And Job listened silently the whole time. There's not a rebuttal from Job in any of what Elihu says. And that doesn't mean that it's necessarily all 100% dead on accurate and correct. But I think he got maybe Job's attention in a way that the other three friends did not. And maybe, you know, maybe Job was just exhausted. I mean, that's certainly a possibility. I mean, I know he was exhausted. And maybe it was just out of exhaustion. I have nothing left to say. Maybe that was it. But I'd like to think that maybe it was more than that. And maybe the words of Elihu were getting through to Job and preparing him. And so ultimately, I really think Elihu's conversation served as a great opening act to the main event that begins today in chapter 38. And here in chapter 38, we finally have God giving his much coveted, much looked for, much demanded response, the beginning of his response to the events that we've been privy to see. Not all of which Job and his friends have been able to see. So let's jump into our text, chapter 38, and I'm just going to read verse 1 to get us started. Then the Lord answered Job out of the storm. He said, and I'm going to stop right in the middle of the sentence because I think it's worth taking a quick look at. We're left to use our imaginations about the storm, or maybe your translation says whirlwind. One of the translations I was looking at said whirlwind. And we're kind of left to use our imaginations about where this whirlwind came from, exactly how it arrived, what that felt and looked and maybe sounded or even smelled or tasted like. I don't know. We're kind of left wondering a little bit. Needless to say, I think it was pretty dramatic. This whirlwind, after all, carried the voice of God. And the Lord's voice was directed squarely at Job. It's also worth mentioning briefly, and I won't go into it. We don't have the time, and I don't have the wisdom, probably. But this isn't the only time God speaks out of the wind. He's done it on different occasions for different reasons. Back in the book of 1 Kings, Elijah was on the run. He had just confronted the prophets of Baal, and he basically, God used him to judge them. And they were wiped out because God consumed the offering and they could not. It's a really great story. I'm not going to look at it. If you have time, I'm sure you probably have seen it. If you haven't, 1 Kings, you would find it in there. But in 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 9, so Elijah did this amazing thing. Well, more appropriately, God did this amazing thing through Elijah, right? And this amazing victory over all these prophets of Baal. And God came up huge. And I mean, there was no doubt that God was the only God, right? And you would think that that would have him feeling maybe a bit unstoppable, right? Like if that is on my side, if God is for me, who can be against me, that kind of thing. But Jezebel wasn't really happy about what happened. And again, I won't go into all the details, but she puts a bounty on his head. And you'd think he'd laugh it off and say, I'll deal with you the same way I dealt with all these ridiculous prophets. And for whatever reason, that wasn't really his response. He decided to go on the run. And in 1 Kings chapter 19, beginning with verse 9, we're going to take a look just briefly at what's taking place here. I'm going to read from 1 Kings 19, verses 9 through 13. And the word of the Lord came to him, that is Elijah. What are you doing here, Elijah? He replied, I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, broken down your altars, and put your prophets to death with the sword. I am the only one left, and now they're trying to kill me too. The Lord said, go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by. Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind this time. After the wind, there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. I just think it's really interesting. We have today God speaking out of this whirlwind. And to Elijah, he started in that whirlwind, or at least that's where the entrance kind of was made maybe. And we get down to this whisper. And for Elijah, he needed to hear the whisper. Apparently God thought that everybody present needed to hear the whirlwind. In Job's and his friend's situation. There are also a couple other interesting connections between God and wind and breath. Of course, in Genesis, God breathes life into Adam. That breath, again, Acts 2, of course, we have the Holy Spirit coming, arriving during Pentecost, and the noise of a violent rushing wind. I just think all these are really interesting, and I'd love to take more time to kind of look at that, but we just don't have that time. But maybe on your own, if you're feeling ambitious, hey, check it out. I think there's some really good stuff in there. But for today, let's get back to our text. Let's read verses. I'm going to start back at verse 1, but I'm going to read through verse 3 this time. Then the Lord answered Job out of the storm. He said, who is this that darkens my counsel with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. Just in case you were wondering if the Lord was showing up to maybe apologize to Job for what had befallen him, or confess any regrets about putting a giant target on Job's back for being such an upright guy. Well, he quickly puts that notion to rest, doesn't he? This is not a hug it out moment. That is not why God has arrived. I can only imagine what Job was thinking when the Lord tells him to brace himself like a man. Just reading in scripture alone, when an angel of the Lord encounters a person, every time the person falls down like they're dead, they're frightened. This is the voice of God addressing Job, and he's saying, brace yourself. I would not want to be. Part of me is like, that would be really interesting. Another part of me is like, no, I'm good with this. I'm braced for this. So next, the Lord begins a series of humbling rhetorical questions to give Job some perspective. And really to all who have ears to hear, I mean, his friends are still there. Elihu is still there. We're still here. So whoever has ears to hear, the Lord has some perspective to offer, okay? So before I get to that, one of my favorite movies is the movie Groundhog Day. I don't know if you've ever seen it, if you're interested in it at all. I think it's funny and charming, and I think there's some really good moral lessons in there. That sounds so stilted and cheesy. It's just it really encourages me when I watch it. I'm like, yeah, I wanna be better. I wanna do good. Anyhow, the short summation, you should watch it. But basically, it's about it's a movie about this guy, Phil Connors. He's played by Bill Murray. And he's a weatherman or a meteorologist. He's called on to travel to Punxsutawney, which, you know, that's kind of cool, too. It's, you know, not that far up the way from us. And he's called to cover Groundhog Day in Punxsutawney. And to put it lightly, this does not excite him at all. He doesn't want to do it. He's dragging his feet. He's just a very bitter and angry person. And on top of the bitter and angry, he gets this work assignment that he's just despising every moment of it. So fast forward, it's still early in the movie, and he's staying in this bed and breakfast. And there's this scene where he wakes up and he goes downstairs. And he's talking to, I guess you could consider her the hostess. She's a gentle, elderly lady. She's in the dining area, tending to the breakfast crowd, making sure they've got coffee and making sure all their needs are met, like a really good person working at a bed and breakfast would be doing. And not knowing Phil is a meteorologist, she engages him in some polite conversation and pleasantly asks, "Hey, how about the weather? Have you heard anything?" And Phil, he responds in his typical jerk fashion with all this highly technical, "Well, the high pressure coming in and the low pressure, and he's doing like he's doing the weather, and he's, you know, and it's going to blow this way, and what that means, it's going to crystallize and blah, 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 and we're just going to, the snow's going to go right by. Did you really want to talk about weather, or were you just making chit-chat?" He just ends with that. And this kind, she doesn't know what to say. I'm sure she's never encountered such a rude person in Punxsutawney before, and she just kind of mumbles, well, yeah, I guess I was just making chit-chat. And he's like, yeah, that's what I thought. And he's kind of off, right? And so I'm bringing this up. I'm not at all suggesting God is a Phil Connors-like jerk. Let me establish that right off the bat, because he is not a Phil Connors-like jerk. But as God begins to lay out all the reasons he and Job and his friends, I'm sorry, when he starts to lay out all the reasons that he is God and Job and his friends are not, it becomes clear that the previous 37 chapters or so contained a group of people just making chit-chat about matters that were clearly above their level of understanding. Just like this lady who was just trying to be polite, she didn't understand all this meteorological babble that he was throwing at her. It was not something that she was equipped to handle. And, you know, God bless them. Job and his friends, they couldn't see it all on their own. They were just making chit-chat for the most part, you know, hypothetically. Well, it might be this, it might be that. What about this? In many ways, they were merely talking about God. They were far from possessing any serious understanding of him, which ultimately is where we all should be trying to get, not just reading a book, but getting to know our God, our Father, our Savior. Back to our text, verses 4 through 6. God says, "Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me, if you understand, who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone?" Regardless of the translation, when we read Genesis chapter 1 and John chapter 1, the in the beginnings is what I'll call them. They both kind of talk about some of these in the beginnings. More so, Genesis elaborately goes into the creation, but also John 1 does in its own way. No matter what translation you read, Job's name does not appear anywhere in any parts of those in the beginnings. There's no, you know, the Lord and Jesus and the Spirit and Job. No. No, Job was not there. God underlines, italicizes, and emboldens this just as a kind reminder to get the conversation started. Back to verse 7. While the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. I wanted to look at that verse alone just real quick because I just think it's such a beautiful account of creation. It might just be poetry, but if the rocks can cry out in worship, maybe the stars had their own melody as they joined in with the angels to worship their creator. It's a beautiful thought. I don't know. That's one of the many questions that we'll be able to ask and discuss. Tell me about that. Tell me about creation. You were there. What was that like? All right. Verses 8 through 11 next. Who shut up the sea behind doors when it burst forth from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and wrapped it in thick darkness, when I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place. When I said, this far you may come and no farther, here is where your proud waves halt. These verses, they're reminiscent to me of Jesus quieting the storm on the Lake of Galilee. And I want to take a look at that real quick. If you want to turn there, you can, but you don't have to. I'm going to. Mark chapter 4. There are different accounts of this in all the Gospels, but I particularly wanted to highlight this one today. Mark chapter 4, beginning with verse 36. We'll just start at verse 35. That day, when evening came, he said to his disciples, that's Jesus, let us go over to the other side. Leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat. There were also other boats with him. A furious squall came up and the waves broke over the boat so that it was nearly swamped. Jesus was in the stern, sleeping on a cushion. The disciples woke him and said to him, Teacher, don't you care if we drown? He got up, rebuked the wind, and said to the waves, Quiet, be still. Then the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? They were terrified and asked each other, Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him. And again, Gina and I did not coordinate the worship set, but that's what we were just singing. And so I feel like the Lord is really trying to highlight and underline that for us. Those storms, God is in control. And I mean, it's almost humorous that Jesus is sleeping through this storm. Now, I don't want us to think that Jesus is sleeping through our storms. He isn't, not at all. He's with us. And whenever we feel like we're going under, when we feel like we're just not going to survive, like it's too much, cry out to him. And I'm not saying that he's going to make it all go away, but he certainly can speak peace, be still to our hearts. And that's really what matters. That's all that matters. That's the only thing that we need to have solidly placed on his foundation. Because the world, I don't know the last time you looked, but the world, it's flying around, right? It's spinning out around this. I don't know how many miles per hour, but it's zinging out there. Our hearts can rest in him no matter what else is going on. All right, let's get back to our text. Verses 12 through 15. Have you ever given orders to the morning or shown the dawn its place that it might take the earth by the edges and shake the wicked out of it? The earth takes shape like clay under a seal. Its features stand out like those of a garment. The wicked are denied their light, and their upraised arm is broken. So going back to verse 11. When I said this far, and you may come no further, here's where your proud waves halt. You know, we take for granted the fact that the earth will just keep orbiting the sun, like I mentioned earlier. We take for granted that that's just going to keep doing what it's doing, that it's just going to keep zinging around. That morning and evening and everything in between, it'll just happen the same as it always has, because the laws of thermodynamics, the laws of gravity, the laws of entropy, the laws of whatever. I don't even know what some of these laws are, right? There's tons of laws out there, right? Sometimes we just take for granted that because of those laws, say it will, it's just going to keep doing what it's doing. But we know the Lord created everything. He set everything in motion. And Jesus holds everything together. In Colossians chapter 1, verse 17, he, that is Jesus, is before all things, Paul tells us, and in him, that is Jesus, all things hold together. In him, all things hold together. It's beautiful. And there's this whole laminin thing, if you've never checked it out from, I wasn't planning on saying that, and I'm drawing a blank on the, does someone know? I can tell you afterwards. It's pretty cool when you look at the really small and you look at the really big, and how God, he's holding it together. He's holding us together, isn't he? He's holding it together. Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's interesting also, you know, we live in a world where science, it's usually pitted against faith, like they're at the opposite ends of the spectrum, like they're just, you know, they're butting heads, like Democrats and Republicans. Just like all truth is God's truth, all true science that is not junk science, which I'm pretty sure there's a lot of that out there. I'm not smart enough to tell you what all is and what all isn't, but the Lord, with his assistance, will help us to discern, I believe. All true science is God's. He is the author of the seasons, the food chain, the speed of light, gravity, every star, everything. He put it together. He is the one who's responsible for all good things. Good science only hopes to unlock some of the mystery. Verses 12 and 15 I thought were really interesting. Kind of odd almost. The wicked are denied their light, is what verse 15 says. When we go back to verse 12, that it may take the earth by the edges and shake the wicked out of it. Don't you wish the Lord would just take the earth by its edges and shake the wicked out of it? I don't know what your translation reads, but that verse got my attention. And I looked at it a little bit, and hopefully you've never experienced this before, but maybe you have gone into a like an outdoor shed or into a damp basement to click on the lights only to see a bunch of cockroaches just scurrying away, trying to get out of the light. That's kind of the idea that he's talking about here, turning the light on and shaking the wicked out away, right? So when the Lord shines his light, the many foul things that are done under the cover of darkness, well, everything becomes clear, doesn't it? And the darkness and everything associated with it, it flees. I just like that passage or that verse. All right, verses 16 through 18. Have you journeyed to the springs of the sea or walked in the recesses of the deep? Have the gates of death been shown to you? Have you seen the gates of the shadow of death? Have you comprehended the vast expanses of the earth? Tell me if you know all this. From the highest heights to the lowest depths, only God knows these. Job, myself, the person who summits Mount Everest, nobody has ever been where the Lord has been and seen all that the Lord has seen. Verses 19 through 21. What is the way to the abode of light, and where does darkness reside? Can you take them to their places? Do you know the paths to their dwellings? Surely you know, for you were already born. You have lived so many years. Just in case someone listening might think, I've climbed pretty high, or I've swam in some pretty deep waters. The Lord asked Job if he can explain where light comes from and if he could elaborate on exactly where the dark lives. It's like a series of why questions coming from a small child. Why do birds eat birdseed? Well, because they need their strength. Why? Because they have to fly. Why? Because around here, it gets cold in the winter and they have to fly south. Why? Because it's warmer in the south. Why? Well, God made it that way. Why? Eventually, even the smartest adult has to concede there are mysteries that we don't know the answer. We don't understand. No matter how many letters are before or after my name, probably before. I guess I could be a fourth in the line of PhDs. No matter how smart or educated I am, there are mysteries that I cannot possibly even begin to scratch the surface of. And the childlike wonder, it reminds us of that. Maybe you've not been around that for some time. Maybe you should be around it again. And to be reminded, you know, to get perspective. This is all about, I believe this is all about perspective. God is, and we are. there are mysteries like this that only God can answer. Verse 22. Have you entered the storehouse of the snow or seen the storehouse of the hail? I just wanted to pause for any Chris Tomlin fans out there. Andrew, I'm looking at you. I don't see you. There you are. Yeah. This is the first of a lot of verses in this chapter that are captured in his song, Indescribable. I just think that's cool. I love when, you know, writers and worship artists can take these scriptural ideas and wrap them in melody and allow us to sing along with them. It's pretty good stuff. All right, verse 23. Well, let me back up to 22. Have you entered the storehouse of the snow or seen the storehouse of the hail, which I reserve for times of trouble, for days of war and battle? Actually, let me read to verse 27. Who cuts a channel for the torrents of rain and a path for the thunderstorm, to water a land where no man lives, a desert with no one in it, to satisfy a desolate wasteland and make it sprout with grass? Did I skip 24? Thank you. Actually, let me go back here. I'm a little out of control. Just a little bit, though. Yeah, let me go back to 23. I'm getting ahead of myself. 22 and 23. Have you entered the storehouse of the snow or seen the storehouse of the hail, which I reserved for times of trouble, for days of war and battle? Sorry about that. God can use anything to further his kingdom on earth. Hail, donkeys, even hornets. And he will use everything for his glory. In Exodus chapter 23, verse 28, and I just want to take a quick look at this verse because it relates to what I'm going to mention next. That's Exodus 23. Verse 28. I will send the hornet ahead of you to drive the Hivites, Canaanites, and Hittites out of your way. So this is in scripture. I'm not making this up, right? The Lord says, I'm going to send these hornets to take these people out, to take these their armies, their well-trained armies, to take them right on out. This is a quote from C.H. Spurgeon that I came across recently. He says, relative to this verse that I just read, God's hornets can do more than our weapons. We could never dream of the victory being won by such a means as Jehovah will use. We must obey our marching orders and go forth to the conquest of the nations for Jesus. And we shall find that the Lord has gone before us and prepared the way, so that in the end, we shall joyfully confess his own right hand and his holy arm have gotten him the victory. Why did God use the youngest of Job's companions to serve as the opening act? Why was David chosen, to the shock of his father, instead of any of his older brothers, to be the next king? It's the same reason God chooses to use common clay pots like you and I to hold the precious gift of the Holy Spirit. It's for his glory. It's for his honor. It's all about him. And if he can take 12, the 12 disciples, you know, they were a wreck. I mean, if you read the Gospels, man, these guys, they did not have it together. Even after walking with Jesus for 3 years of his life, I mean, the greatest teacher you could ever walk with. And they were still so clueless about so many things. And God said, I want these 12. Why? Why would he choose those 12? Why would he choose me? Well, he wants to use the foolish things, right? He deserves the honor and glory. And so he'll use the hornet, and he'll use you and me, if we allow him to, for his glory. Now, apparently I was very excited to get to verses 24 through 27. Let's see if it was worth the buildup. Verses 24 through 27. I'm not going to read Exodus. That's going to confuse everybody. What is the way to the place where the lightning is dispersed, or the place where the east winds are scattered over the earth? Who cuts a channel for the torrents of rain and a path for the thunderstorm, to water a land where no man lives, a desert with no one in it, to satisfy a desolate wasteland and make it sprout with grass? So, I promise to be brief here, but I wanted to talk just a little bit about the planet Jupiter, right? It's the largest planet in our system. It's the fifth planet from the sun, and it's about 365 million miles away from Earth. That's a long way away. I remember first learning about the Great Red Spot on Jupiter, and maybe you have no idea what I'm talking about, or maybe you have some idea, or maybe you've seen a picture before and didn't think much of it. To me, I thought this was really interesting. So there's this giant red spot that you can always, it's like what Jupiter is kind of most known for, at least to the layperson like me. You look at pictures and there's this giant red spot in the middle and you're like, what's that thing? Okay, so this giant red spot. It's actually a raging anticyclonic storm. I don't know exactly what that means, but it's a really big storm doing kind of crazy stuff. That's the Dave Trout version of what a anticyclonic storm is. It's the largest known storm in our entire solar system, larger than our entire planet. The storm is larger than our planet. I don't know. It just kind of blows my mind. So this huge storm, it's producing winds up to 270 miles per hour. It's believed that this storm has existed for at least 360 years. Maybe this is completely uninteresting to you, and you're like, I wish he would stop talking about this because I'm going to fall asleep or leave. That's all I'm going to say about that. The factual stuff, the details, for some reason, it blows my mind. It's hard for me to comprehend how this massive, epic storm so far away from us, where there are no buildings, there are no reporters, there are no people, there's nothing out there. The largest storm in our solar system, it's been happening for over three centuries. Practically nobody even cares or knows about it. This planet and storm, they're just one of a billion. What's a number bigger than a billion? 2 billion. Whatever the number is, right? All the other planets and storms and amazing formations out there that we will never, ever even see until, I believe, until we get home, and then we'll have plenty of time to travel. We'll never see with our human eyes, never set foot on, and God created it all. Why? Why would he create these things so elaborate and so far away that we'll most likely never even hear of or see or catch wind of? And I don't think it has anything to do with aliens or extraterrestrials. If you want to believe in that, okay, that's fine. I mean, I don't think it says in the Bible that, you know, believing in aliens is evil. I tend to think that there's no such thing. I believe that Genesis 1, 14 through 18, it kind of lays it out for us, and I won't read it because we're running out of time, but basically it lets us know God put these heavenly bodies where they are to give light, and so we can see them. I mean, God is the greatest artist who's ever lived, and I think he just kind of... I'm lacking a better phrase, but he kind of just went crazy. God's not crazy. He just kind of went crazy artistically, and he just, man, he didn't hold back. And so the deeper we see with our telescopes, and the more satellites we launch out, and the more we learn, God's like, yep, I'm even bigger than that. I'm even more amazing than that. Get to know me. That's the missing part, that so many people, that, man, it's so, if they're there and they're amazed at that, they're so close, just a little bit further. And there's this, right, we just had the eclipse. There was this really cool, and I won't again, we're running out of time, but I'd seen it kind of making the social rounds, the social medias, and it basically just said, for those who think that we're just an accident, we're able to predict these types of events hundreds of years in the future, and based on, you know, information from the past, we can know when the next eclipse is going to be. That's no accident. That is an intelligent designer, and that phrase even is insulting to say an intelligent. I mean, God made this. If you can't see it, it's just because you've been blinded. And I pray that your eyes can be opened the way that our eyes have been opened. I could go on and on, but I don't have time to go on and on. We need to finish up our text. Okay, verse 28. And we are going to be wrapping it up here shortly. Does the rain have a father who fathers the drops of dew? From whose womb comes the ice? Who gives birth to the frost from the heavens? When the waters become hard as stone, when the surface of the deep is frozen. God didn't just create everything on a whim so that he could up and sell it at a yard sale. He is intimately connected to all he creates. And of course, nothing more intimately than you and I, his greatest creation. Verses 31 through 33. Can you bind the beautiful? Can you bind the beautiful Pleiades? Can you loose the cords of Orion? Can you bring forth the constellations and their seasons, or lead out the bear with its cubs? Do you know the laws of the heavens? Can you set up God's dominion over the earth? God told Abraham that his descendants would be as numerous as the stars in the sky. And there's a really cool passage about how God called each star out by name. And if he cares about those stars that much, and I know he does, he cares so much more about you and I. Verses 34 through 38. Can you raise your voice to the clouds and cover yourself with a flood of water? Do you send the lightning bolts on their way? Do they report to you, here we are? Who endowed the heart with wisdom or gave understanding to the mind? Who has the wisdom to count the clouds? Who can tip over the water jars of the heavens when the dust becomes hard and the clods of earth stick together? There is only one source of wisdom and understanding. There's just one. All truth is God's truth. And good science supports that as well. Yeah, let's just read on here and finish up. Do you hunt the prey for the lioness and satisfy the hunger of the lions when they crouch in their dens or lie in wait in a thicket? Who provides food for the raven when its young cry out to God and wander about for lack of food? This to me, and this is the last scripture that we'll take a look at because we're out of time. But this reminds me, it makes me think of Matthew 6. Matthew 6, 26, to be specific. And if you know the... Well, you've probably heard this before, but I just want to read it real quick here. Matthew 6, 26. And again, this is in the chapter that yours may not be titled this, but mine is titled, Do Not Worry. Okay, Matthew 6, 26. Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Who of you by worrying can add a single hour to his life? If his eye is on the raven and the sparrow, and it was surely on Job, even though it didn't feel like it to him, it's certainly on you and me. And if you have a second to read Romans 1:20, we all know it. Creation points to a creator God. We are without excuse. And we don't, man, we are so blessed. Where would we be without the Lord? And I find myself asking so often, I don't know how people get through X without the Lord. Whatever it is, whether it's a tragedy, whether it's, you know, COVID, whether it's, you know, really hard car trouble, I don't know how people get through X without the Lord. And the truth is, I don't know that they do get through it. I mean, I think it's killing them. And they need the Lord like we've found him. And he's good and he's faithful. And I won't go on and on, but I'm thankful that his eye is on the sparrow and it was on Job and it's on us. And he's not going anywhere, folks. He's a good God. And he's got this. He has got this and he's got you if you've got him. So let's close with prayer. And if there are any final thoughts, we can entertain those as well. So, Lord, we are thankful. We're thankful for you. We're thankful that you wanted us, that you created us, that you, after we rebelled against you, that you came after us again and again and again and again and again and again. And you just won't let us alone where we are unless we absolutely want to be there. And I don't know who wants to be alone. Lord, open our eyes to see you more clearly, to know you more fully. We're thankful for your words that you spoke to Job. I'm thankful for his life, for all that he went through, not just so we could read about it, but in part so we could read about it and draw near to you through it. And we just give you all the honor and the glory, and we thank you for being in control. We pray in your Son, Jesus' name.